Hey everybody out there, I am so excited about this because we are now doing a special video here, a special interview. I'm actually the one who's going to be interviewed with some critical Christians. Ta-da! And I hope I'm ready for that, but I think I am. This is my friend and he's going to just introduce himself and say who he is and why we are doing this special interview, and then he will start to interview me. So I hope you're ready. It's going to be a little long video compared to some of the other videos we have, but I really believe that this will help many and set people free and answer some of the questions people may have about me, about the Last Reformation.
Yeah, hey, thank you very much for this opportunity, Torben. I am Joel and I am from Switzerland. I'm pastor there for now around 4 years and I'm leading a church in Winterthur. And at this moment we set up a pioneer training school in Switzerland. We will start at the 13th March and I'm so excited about that. Then we had a long time behind us that it was not so easy only to go away with the Last Reformation. I saw this movie and I saw also these lessons, these 24 lessons now who are out, and I was so touched by the Holy Spirit when I saw these lessons, and I saw that there is something that I miss sometimes in the churches, and I want to become more and more a true follower of Jesus Christ. But I saw also that there are so many pastors and church leaders, they have problems about the Last Reformation. They have so many questions. They are thinking that sometimes that's a wrong doctrine we have here. And about that, I want to ask some different questions to Torben. And I hope so that it can be really something that is helpful to understand what's going on here with the Last Reformation.
So I think this video in many ways is Christian pastors and leaders are asking, but for you who are not pastor leaders, I hope that this is a video you can share with pastors and leaders and people you know around, who maybe have the same questions. I hope I'm ready. No, okay, but you just take off and you ask, and I would say I would answer as direct and truthful as possible, and I'm not here to please anyone. But I just want to show my heart in it and where I come from and where we are, and I think it will help many people.
So. Yes, very good. So, okay, let's start. One of the first questions I want to ask you is why your focus is so strong into the book of Acts. We have also other letters in the Bible who teach us about carrying each one another. But you are so focused on kickstarting people, on baptism in the Holy Spirit, the baptism in water, repentance, and all this stuff, and healings. What do you say to this?
To this, okay. When I talk about the book of Acts and why I focus a lot about the book of Acts is for different reasons. First thing, when we talk about the disciple life Jesus called us to do, we will not go back to Samuel, or to Ezekiel, or to Judges, to teach out of the disciple life there. Why? Because you see pictures, but you don't see the clear pattern. You don't see how they were living because it was before the cross. The same way when we talk about the Gospels is important. I'm actually, when I'm out during Kisa weekend, we talk about the Gospels. But the Gospels is not so clear a mirror for us that show us how we should live today. Why? Because the Gospels were still before the cross. The Gospels was before nobody got baptized to Jesus, before Jesus died on the cross, before the Holy Spirit was given on earth. So therefore, I think if we want to show and go in and look at how the Christian life, how the disciple life should be living, we need to go to the time we are living in now, and we are living after the cross. We don't need to wait in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit is getting poured out, because the Holy Spirit is already here. So today is salvation, today's new covenant, it has started. Why then the book of Acts and not the letters? I don't say that I don't use the letters. I actually, if people go and see the Pioneer School, I've done now 24 lessons, but the first 20 lessons, it's not only about healing. It's not only about that, it's big part of it. But I actually have one lesson, one big lesson where I'm going through the book of Hebrews, where I systematically go through the book of Hebrews to show from one end to another end who God is in the book of Hebrews. And I think most of the critical question is also because people have only seen a few videos and have not seen it all. But why then the book of Acts so much? Because the letters is written to already believers. So you don't see in the letters people actually come to faith, repent, how they go out with the gospel. You don't see that. The only book in the whole Bible that is a history book is the book of Acts. And that is the only book where we see the beginning point of the life.
Mm-hmm.
The last Reformation right now is a new movement, it's something new God is doing, and we are trying to take it step by step. In the first movie we have done, The Last Reformation, The Beginning, it's called The Beginning. If you see that movie, you would then say, oh, why do you focus so much? So again, repentant, baptism, water, baptism, Holy Spirit, the only thing you focus about in the book of Acts. Yes, why? Because the book of Acts is the beginning. This is where people start to see their life. But the next movie we're coming out with in October called The Last Reformation, The Life, we are focused on other things like persecution and how the life is now living. And the next movie later again will focus more on the churches, mm-hmm. and there we will come more into the letters.
Yeah.
So I would say, for us, I think it's important that we start with the foundation, and the foundation is Christ, the foundation is the gospel. This is the cross. Jesus died, he got buried, he rose up again. We need to repent, die from ourselves, get buried through water and rise up again, power of the Holy Spirit. And then we live as a life of disciple life. So when we are out doing Kickstart weekends, I always start with the same thing. It's actually the same thing I do all over again. Why? Because this is the foundation people need. If I go to the same group,
mm-hmm.
many times who have gone through the same thing, there I will talk about other things. There, of course, we'll talk about the letters. There I will talk about this. There I will talk about the life.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the reason some people are skeptical and think it's only the book of Acts is that they don't see the full picture of what we are doing. One thing, the other thing, they don't know it, they don't see the importance of the book of Acts, because the book of Acts is important. This is the only book we actually have in the whole entire Bible where we see what people need to do to get saved.
Mm.
We don't see anybody get saved in the letters because they are already saved. Paul, Peter, James, Judas, those who wrote the letters wrote to the saint in that city, to the saint in that city, to the saint in that city. The letters was never written to the sinners, but to the saints. And I would say, therefore, I love the book of Acts.
Yeah.
I think the book of Acts is given for that purpose, to show the church how the life start and how the life is living.
Yeah.
And about healing, there I would say also, if people see the Pioneer Training School, we have 20 lessons. I have one or two lessons out of 20 about healing.
Mm.
That is 10%. If you go through the Gospels and look at Jesus' life, I would say that 25% was about healing Americans, cast out demons.
Yeah.
It was 25%. So why do you see that so big part of Jesus' life if it's wrong? Because don't believe it's wrong. Healing had to do with the heart of God. It had to do with the gospel. It had to do with people. It had to do with is important when it comes to it. I say also in the Pioneer Training School, if you only preach, then you only have a half gospel. If you only heal, you only have a half gospel. I don't see that Jesus have allowed us to only preach the gospel. I don't find any place in the Bible where he actually says, now you go out and preach, stop there. Or now you go out and heal and cast out demons, stop there. He always combined healing and preaching. Mm-hmm. Healing and preaching.
As a full package.
At the full package. Yeah. And I am not a healing guy. I'm not, you never find me, for example, do meetings now where I advertise, come and get healed. Mm-hmm. Because I don't personally get sacrificed by doing healing meetings. I will never be able to just sit down and talk 1 hour only if I'm a place about healing. But I can also not go without coming into healing. Why? Because healing is part of that package.
Yeah.
So we can say, when people ask Christian, sometimes we will say the opposite. Ask Christian back and say, okay, what is the balance? Because there's people who think we are too much about healing. But when is too much and when is too little? We know one thing for sure, that we should heal the sick. I have met people where I personally think it's too much. But I've also met people where it's too little.
Yeah.
Where's the balance? I would say, as long as we have everything, I think it's good.
So you mean that the balance is about where is it your focus? The focus is not on healing, primarily.
Mm.
It's about the gospel and
it's yeah.
to have a demonstration about God's power.
Yeah. But again, of course, if you see our videos, there's things that's not easy to get on video. You can film healing because healing is happening right that moment. You can film taking people out on the street and kickstart is happening that moment. A big part of for us being a disciple of Jesus is persecution.
Mm-hmm.
And we actually talk about persecution, we actually talk about suffering.
Yeah.
But try to put that on a video. Try to like, okay, this is a life. It's not easy to get out there, but it's also part of it. We are talking about loving.
Yeah.
We are talking about giving. We are talking about this fruit of the Spirit. We talk about humility.
Yeah.
Try to film humility. 1 hour humility with Tom Søndergaard. It's not easy to get out. It's not easy to get on film. But again, if you didn't see the book of Mark, book of Mark is a book with action. Do. He did it. He did miracles. He healed. He did wonders. He healed. He cast out demons. He preached. He healed. Do.
Yeah.
Then you can say, Jesus, what about the rest? But why is those things written? For people to know that Jesus is the Son of God.
Yes.
Why do we do what we're doing for people to know that Jesus is the Son of God?
Yes.
When people see, they will believe.
Yeah.
And I was just in Brazil 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
In a hotel, we pray for people. People fall down because they're free from demons. A lot of things happen. A guy who was working there came to me and said, I'm living in sin. I need to repent. I need Jesus. We have not preached to this guy. But he have already heard the word in his church. And by seeing the power of God, by seeing the miracle, he got convinced in his heart, he repented, and he got the Holy Spirit. And his life got changed.
Yeah.
So I would say, also with if when we talk about the kickstart and healing, there is a two-step in that. There is the one step is disciple. No, there's the obeying Jesus' word, go out, heal the sick, preach the gospel, cast out demons, lead people to Christ, so on.
Yeah.
But there is also the part making disciples. Because most of what we do out on the street is actually equipping the saint to obey Jesus in everyday life.
Yeah.
And therefore, the healing part, it looked like it's so much more because it's... Let's say like that. People say, but you're out. You're talking about going out and kickstart. Yeah, but kickstart and going out is not only healing.
Yeah.
It's discipleship. And out on the street, when we are kickstart people, we are teaching at the same time. We are talking about Jesus. We are talking about life. We are praying for those people we are taking out.
Yeah.
So there's so much more in it than just go out, pray for somebody, and go home again.
Yes.
And personally, I don't like people who just go out and pray for people and share testimony and go home again. I believe there should be more in it to that. I think it's just part of the big picture.
So that we really have this package.
Yeah.
Both.
Yeah.
And perhaps a question in this, when we speak about healing. What do you think is the difference how you teach healing to how perhaps Redding or Bill Johnson or someone else teach about healing? What do you think? Where is the difference?
Yeah. I would say there's many, many people come to me often and say, Tom, what do you think about him and her and them and this ministry and this ministry? My answer is very often that when Jesus was living on earth, he was living in a time without internet, without Facebook, without YouTube. I don't think they knew that there was America. They did not know about Denmark. Why? Because they were living in a radius of 50 kilometers, many of them. Jesus, he lived 50 kilometers radius almost, and they lived at 70. They lived in that area.
Yeah.
Of course, Paul traveled and Peter traveled, but they never came to America. It was too far. They did not know about it.
Yes.
Now the world is so much smaller suddenly, and suddenly we need to deal with so many questions. What about him? What about them? What about them? When talking about Bill Johnson and Redding, I don't know them. I've never met them. I never sit down with them. And with many ministry, I have decided I don't want to go in there and judge them out of the few rumors I've heard. And I'm actually not a guy who's sitting on YouTube and seen a lot of video for other people. So to answer that, I need to look more into it. What I have heard, one of the different is maybe the focus on the anointing, where people focus more on the anointing and gifting and transferring things and lay hands on people, where we believe we have everything in Jesus Christ. You don't need me or anybody else to lay hands on you. If you have the Holy Spirit, you can just go out and do it. But what other do you? I actually don't want to answer. Also, for other things, when talking about YouTube and videos, personally, I'm glad that there was no internet 20 years ago. Because when I started 20 years ago, I did many crazy things and had many crazy teaching. And I've been in on a journey and I've learned so much in my desert period. And I've changed theology many times. So if you see critical videos of people doing weird things, give people a chance to change, give people a chance to repent and change. Because about weird manifestations, I don't want to, it's a whole subject for itself right now. I believe there's weird manifestations out there in the church I don't like. I think some of this is fleshly, I think some of this is soulish, like that. But also some of it actually can be demonic. Some of those things I actually came from years ago because I got saved in a church where they were doing crazy things. And I was part of that. Today I know that it was soulish.
Yeah.
At that time I thought it was God. Today I know it's soulish. So if people did a video of me that time and it was on YouTube, everybody would say, Tom, he is believing in holy laughter and running around on the floor and laugh. Look at him, look at him. This is what he's doing. No, it was what I did. Because I was new in the faith and I did not know better. And I believe in that way we are all changing.
Yeah.
And I think this is the challenge with it when we are public person who give out things that people don't allow us to change. And I've changed a lot. I've learned a lot. Every year, the last years. Yeah.
Before you speak about this anointing, and you say really strong and so much that it is for every follower of Jesus Christ. Why you come to this resume?
For me, I came from a background, a faithful background, where I was one of the ones who was sitting on the pew and waiting for man of God to come and lay hands on me so I could receive that anointing so I can go out and do it. I got disappointed after waiting, and nothing happened. And then I left it, left the church, and then I started to just do it. And I grow in doing it, and I actually dare study the Bible, and I saw that I already have it. And people, the New Testament talking about the anointing is talking about the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. When talking about laying on our hands, it's talking about baptism with the Holy Spirit. When talking about being filled by the Holy Spirit, it's not a feeling that's coming from people outside laying hands on you. It's when you now have received it, it's coming from inside. From inside, it was run out like living water. And this is what we then saw, because then we start to teach and disciple people, and where people come to us, and without laying hands on them, we just showed them what they already had, the Holy Spirit, and we took them out. And what happened? They saw the same healing, they saw the same power, they saw people set free, and they saw a lot of fruit. Without me or anybody else laying hands on them to receive our extra anointing. And I see it's biblical to do like that. In the Old Testament, it was different. But now we live in the New Testament where the Spirit is given to everyone. And the good thing with that is that you are not dependent on a man. And you don't need to sit and wait for a special gift. You have it already and you can just do it. And I think that is why the last Reformation is exploding the way it is. Because people just do it. Like I got a testimony yesterday for a woman in Brazil,
mm-hmm.
who have not been at Kickstart, who have not connected with anyone, who just found the Pioneer School, who saw the teaching, she laid hands on herself, she got healed after 4 years because she suddenly understood it, and now she's baptized people, leading people to Christ and living the life. And there have not been anyone from us laying hands on her.
Yeah.
She had not received anything new. She already had the Holy Spirit, but she became aware of what she already had. And I think there is something healthy in this.
Yeah.
Because then it's not about man and special anointing, and we put people up in a pedestal and almost worship them and think, I need to buy their books. I need to have what they have. But people already have it.
Yeah.
I think maybe this is what I really go to and why I'm so hard in that. It's because I left that church 20 years ago and started to do it. And many of those people are still sitting in the same church and still waiting
yeah.
for that special thing. And in all of those years, I've been growing and learning. And I say the teacher about the anointing and special gift is we think it set people free, but they actually do the opposite. It, those people who experience God in a way, they get bold by it because now they believe they have it. But we also have a big, big scar of people who are still waiting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But why every single one who follows Jesus Christ has to go to the streets?
Okay. Do people need to go to the street? Again, I would say that when I started with the videos, it was kickstarting out on the street. And the whole kickstart thing is exploding now. And you can use kickstart. If you say kickstart in churches, people know what it is. It actually started here with idea, let's call it Kickstarter and let's do that. So that was the beginning point of it. And it's a good beginning. It's an amazing beginning. If I only have, let's say if I only have 1 hour with a group of people, what will I do that 1 hour? If they're not born again, I will spend the time to preach the gospel. If they're born again, there were so many things I could teach about. I could teach about this and this and holiness and Holy Spirit and sound doctrine and fear of God and love of God. And I could teach about many things. But if I only have 1 hour with somebody who were born again, I would take them out on the street and kickstart them. Why? Because if those believers see God use them, something is starting
yeah.
them. They get excited and that create a that God become more real in their life, and that dude at the study, they see God, they start to fast, they start to pray, they start to lead people to Christ. So kickstarting is start of so many other things. Do I believe that everybody always should run out on the street? No. My wife is not running out on the street.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. She's not. Never, actually. My wife, she... me and my wife are totally different.
So you think there's also a possibility to be Christ, a follower of Christ, and not going out on the street?
I would say that if you look at the Bible,
yeah.
my wife is a wife. she's a mother, and we have three kids, and she's, you know, she's doing music and singing, and she's in a pioneer school. If I should do music and sing, go bad. If she should do what I'm doing, preaching, will go bad.
Yeah.
Why? Because we are different. If I look at my three kids, I have a girl, Simone, 11, Stephanie, 15, Sonny, 18. Simone, she's like me. She's outward, bold girl who love action. And she had been kickstarted, and she had been praying for people when she was 10. I have Stephanie. She's totally different than Simone in that way. She's like my wife. And then we have Sonny. He's a little between. She's a little like me, but also a little like my wife. Us who have kids, we know that this has nothing to do with social environment, because all three grow up in the same family, the same social environment, but all three are totally different when it comes to some areas. I believe that is creation. God created us with different gifting. But we are all disciples. We are all called to make disciples. And that is to share Jesus. That is to heal the sick. That is to cast out demons. That is to lead people to Christ. But that thing can then look different. Like my wife, she take people into our house, and there's people who have been living in our house, and she have been helping them and praying with them and praying for them and cast out demons, helping with them in our house, where I'm doing other things. And Sonny, my son, he's also teaching people or meeting people on the street, but he's not exactly the same way we're doing. So I would say, when people come and see the PTS, the whole part, our training school, the whole idea with Kickstart is not to let everyone end out on the street, because I don't think we are ever going to come back. The whole idea with Kickstart is to let everyone learn to heal the sick, preach the gospel, lead people to Christ, so they can do it in their life.
So you think this is only one part that can be useful to learn how the Holy Spirit wants to use us?
But yeah, like we are all disciples, but if you look at the Bible, there was Paul traveling around all over the world. There was Peter, who was traveling around, but was mostly in Jerusalem. Then there was a guy like Ananias, the guy Ananias who led Paul to Christ. He was a certain disciple.
Yeah.
Then there was Philip and the seven in Book of Acts there who came to Samaria. You see, they were all part of the kingdom work. They were all part of leading people to Christ. They were all part of doing things. Philip, Paul did it mainly in Jerusalem. Philip, he went to Samaria.
Yeah.
Paul, he went all over the world. And Ananias, he went to the house of where Paul was.
Yeah.
And I believe today, the same today, we will see people who will be mainly in one city. You see people who will be mainly in other cities, you see people who are traveling all over the world, and you see people who are mainly in the houses, who actually, maybe you don't see them on YouTube, you don't see them traveling all over the world, but they are led by the Holy Spirit, and they are sitting in a house, and in private houses, they are healing the sick, they are casting out demons in their way, and with their personality. They are maybe more soft, they are more counseling type, they are maybe better of sitting and listening to people and have a more shepherd heart in it and love to sit down with people and listen to their story a whole hour or 2 hours before they then pray for them, before they then lead them to Christ and baptize the Holy Spirit. Beautiful. And we need that. We need those different things come together.
Yeah.
But again, how do you film that? How do you get them up? Those people who then do the YouTube videos and put on YouTube is those people who are out there, do, direct.
Yeah.
And we see that on YouTube. We don't see on YouTube those housewife, like my wife, who's doing things on her way, or other people who have kids, who are sitting there with the kids and playing and talking with the neighbor wife, who also have kids, and they are sharing Jesus, and actually baptizing one that year. You don't put that on YouTube, why? Because it's not easy to film, because it's not happening that second, it happened over that period of life. But we believe in different gifting in that way that we are different. from creation, but we are all still disciples. So we are all called to preach Jesus, to pray for people, yeah. and we can all do that. Yeah. But how that look is different. That has to do with personality and who you are.
And what's about the call they have? They have to be obedient to the call, you think? Yeah. Or?
Yeah, I would say, but we all change. When I started many years ago, I did not like Christians. In that way, I thought they were too lazy. Let's go out on the street. We want to reach people. I was what I call from the beginning a typical church evangelist. I was only out there. It was yeah. my only focus. But together with growing, for me, my focus changed. Yeah. And it became other things. And it became more teaching yeah. and apostolic work and building things. But so there's things I'm stronger in and weaker in. I'm not the most shepherdy type in that way that I'm not the person who normally sit down with people for 3-4 hours and just listen to the life story. It's not who I am. But if I'm sitting in a situation with a person who have a need and I'm there, I will never say, sorry, this is not who I am. Why? Because I'm still a Christ body, I'm still a disciple. And if there is a need, I will do it.
Mm.
So I would say that if people are free to follow Christ, but I believe it's important to teach people that we can do everything in Christ. So if the Holy Spirit lead them to a thing, then they don't say, sorry, I don't pray because I don't have that gift. Or sorry, I cannot baptize because, or sorry, I cannot listen to your story because this is not who I am. I think our focus is following Christ, be like Christ, and if the Holy Spirit set us in a situation
yeah.
where he lead us to something,
mm-hmm.
then I believe we can do it. How do the Holy Spirit lead people? It is different yeah. from person to person at the same time. Yeah.
So the primary focus is be obedient to that, what God has put yeah. in your heart.
And let the Holy Spirit let the Holy Spirit develop you and grow. Mm-hmm. So in things you are not strong, you become stronger.
Yeah.
So also if there is things I know I'm weak in and I know it's not what I'm going to use my whole future on, but I will still work with that area I'm weak in because I want to be stronger in that area yes. at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
But of course I know what I'm best for.
Yeah.
And so I would say it's just live with God and be led by Spirit. And when we come together and the PTS schools we have all over, the focus is actually just encouraging the saints to be like Christ where they are.
Yeah.
And that result of that equipping, it's so different. Some people are traveling all over the world. Some people are in the houses doing house fellowship. Some people are working on the street.
Yeah.
And it is really different from place to place. And in the next movie we are doing called Last Reformation, The Life, we want to try to show you different examples of how we look, where it's not only the street, but also how do you look in the houses.
Yeah. I heard people asked about kickstarting.
Yeah.
What's happening afterwards?
Yeah. Yeah.
Brazil, I don't know, America or whatever.
Yeah.
What do you say to them? What's happened there?
Oh, with the fruit.
Yes, yeah. Perhaps when I go to Brazil,
yeah.
what I will find.
Okay. I would say that the focus of many pastors and leaders is to grow their church. The focus of what we are doing is to grow the kingdom. And it's very different from what a normally church conference look like, because if we go a place, some places we are, there have been church invited us and we have been working therefore with that church, and you can see the fruit in the church afterwards. But it's very different place to place, because very often people come from all over the place, all over the city, all over, not only say the country, and from other countries. For example, when I was just in Brazil, for example, a few weeks ago, I asked how many came here by plane. And it was like 40% who came with plane. That is out of, I think there was 800 people, 40% of them flew in. How many drive more than 2 hours? And he was like, most people. So why, or many people, why is it like that? Because we have been there when people come from all over. So when we train people, the fruit afterwards cannot always be seen on that local place, because some place we go where there was actually only 2, 3, 5 people who invite us, or there was only a small group. And if you go to that group and talk with some of those local people are bearing fruit. Those local people are seeing a growth. But you don't see that in local church, because it's people who are bearing fruit, and it's all over the place. So there is a lot of fruit happening out there. We have then heard people say, what about baptism? How do you follow up on baptism and so on? When we are doing a Kickstart weekend, a training weekend, our focus is not to go out and get people saved. Our focus is to train and equip believers to live like Christ. The fruit of that is people getting saved. But if I go to a place and I do want to go out and see people saved, I take them in, I lead them to Christ, I baptize them with the Holy Spirit, and then I'm gone again the next day to a new country. If I was the only contact that person had, what then? I will not be able to follow up on that person at all. And that's why I believe that when we are out there, we train and equip the local people to see fruit. And those people who are then out, who lead people to Christ, baptize people, they are the ones who then follow up on them. How that look is different. In the Bible, there is example where we see Philip baptized the eunuch, and as soon as Philip, book of Acts 8, baptized the eunuch, God took Philip away. So who followed up on the eunuch? I don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know, but God is in control. And I have stories of people where local people baptized, they follow up. I have stories of people where I lead people to Christ, baptize them, I'm gone, and then I meet them 5 years later and they're strong in God because the Holy Spirit have led them to other believers. So it's so different from place to place. What I can say is there is a lot of fruits out of what we are doing. And there's people all over who are strong, who are growing, and I love that. So it's not, for example, if I get invited to a church, I don't want to do a church conference and only speak to that one church. I want to build with what we are doing, and therefore I can do it in a church. There can be a pastor, but I make it clear that this is not about that church, it's about the kingdom. And this is our focus, and that's why it's different from the traditional come to my church, do a conference, and what is the fruit afterwards in that church. I don't measure fruit of how many new members there is sitting in that church. I measure fruit of how many people who become disciples and bear fruit, and how they lead them to Christ, what they then do with them, and what happened is so different. Some people attend church, some people start new fellowship, some people just meet with groups, it's different, and I will let God work with that.
Yeah. Good. So I go a little bit forward. My question too is there. You, at the time you have spoken about the churches, and I heard often people who say you are against church. What's happened with that?
Yeah, I'm against church. I would say that there is a truth in that. But there is a challenge with what we're doing. First thing, define church. And the thing with word against, what is against and what is church, and what is, how do people hear it? For example, when we talk about words, are you religious?
I would say no.
No, okay. I would also say no when people ask, I'm religious. But in Denmark, we have a Lutheran church, and people who are in the Lutheran church, believers, they use the word religious in a positive way. So if somebody is very strong believers and really love Jesus in that way and do what they do, they will be very religious. So if we speak to them and we say, come on, you should not be religious. They are hearing it. Oh, you should not be a believer. What? And there is a lot of confusion happening in Denmark, because the same word religious in one place is positive, in another place is negative. Yeah. When I talk about church, I try to divide it up between church as people coming together as the body of Christ, and church as a system like the Lutheran church. Am I against church like the body of Christ? No. I speak in more churches than most people. I work with more churches than most people. And many people who are just in church. We are doing a PTS school now in the church you have in Switzerland, and you are a priest and you are sitting here and you have not yet stoned me. We are starting churches. I'm not against church. I'm not against the body of Christ. I believe in church out of what I understand church. When we talk about church as the Lutheran church, am I against that? Yes, I am. Do I say that everything is bad in Lutheran church? I don't know everything in the Lutheran church. I know there is believers there who really love Jesus and are real in their life what they believe in Jesus. But I still think it's bad. Why? Because they have wrong doctrines. When it comes to baptism, baptism is important. They need the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And I think that that is dangerous. But that is also a small part of what the Lutheran church is. That is, we talk about under 1%. We talk about 0.1% in Denmark who's like that. The 99.9%, let's say like that, are like my brother who died 2 years ago. Not last year, actually. He died last year. He died of cancer. When I became a Christian, my brother will not hear about Jesus. He was making fun with Jesus. And when he got sick of cancer, he did not want me to pray for him. And they will not have anything to do with it. And it was really hard to look at. And he became more and more sick. And I couldn't reach him. He didn't want it. And then he died. Then he got buried in Lutheran church, where my family was, my whole family who are not believers, where the city I knew grow up in was. And there the priest stood up and said, everything is okay. Why? Because 45 years ago, my brother there, he got baptized in the same church. And because of that baby baptism, he is now, there's no hell anymore. Everybody's in heaven. That is a lie. And what the priest said, everybody heard of my family, my friends, and everyone. And they go from there thinking, okay, if the Bible is correct, because in their head, in Denmark, the Lutheran church is the church. This is what God is doing. This is the Bible. This is the priest. If that is correct, everything is okay. Why? Because everybody got water in the head as a baby in the Lutheran church. We are free churches. We look at that and shake our head and know, of course, this is a lie. This is wrong. People need to get born again. And I would say that I'm against that. In that way, not in that way that I'm standing with a big billboard outside the church. And I'm against it in that way that I'm preaching the truth. And I think the best way to go against lies is to just preach the truth. And I do that. Mm-hmm. And I would say, most born again, everybody born again believer could follow me in this example and say this is really a bad example. Yeah. And it's so sad. When we then go a step further and try to look at what we are doing as the free church, the Pentecostal church and so on, I would say I've changed the last years that I've seen a danger in what we're doing. Because we can know a tree by the fruit. If the focus is here, the focus is to create, have people come together on Sunday and meet and have a good life and believe in Jesus and be nice Christian the everyday life and so on, then we will not have a problem with this church and everything we do is fine. But if the focus was, the goal was this instead, And Jesus was saying, for example, Luke 10, go out in the houses and we are all disciples and preach the gospel and do this and do this. If that was the goal and we end up with a different goal,
yes,
then there's a problem.
Yeah.
And I would say that in my journey, I have seen that what we thought was the goal is not the biblical goal. The biblical goal is not people coming and sitting down and hear a sermon and be nice Christian. The goal was obedience and strong disciples in everyday life. And out of the way we do church today, the fruit, we just need to admit that the fruit, general, is not good. If you look at America, of those people who attend those churches, only 10% who actually open the Bible during the week. The rest, 90%, come into a life where the Christian life become 2 hours on Sunday. Okay. The fruit is that after 10 years, 50 years sitting in a church, the life is gone. The fruit is that they sin, that people do not obey. The fruit is meaning people have fallen away by getting cold in the heart when it comes to that. When that is said, there is, of course, different churches. There is, of course, people out there who are doing an amazing job. You are, you yourself are a priest in a church. And we are now starting a pioneer training school with you in your church, in that. And if so, if I was against all of that, I would not be able to do what I do with you and sit with you as a priest and work with you and so on. But so when I'm talking about the church and I see the problem in the church, I'm talking about the church where there is a problem.
Yeah.
And I would say, so when I'm, and that is the difficult word again, I can say something and what I say factual, I would say it's the truth that there is a problem. Factual, there is many people who are deceived. If you see in Lutheran church, they do not have that, they do not have this, they do not have that. And I need to preach hard, I need to show it what the truth is. I could, every time I open my mouth and say, this, but, I'm not talking about those 5%, I'm not talking about that 1%, I'm not talking about, but if I need to do that every single time, I'm losing the message, because it would be too difficult.
Yeah.
So I am provoking, I am saying something direct. And there is a few people who listen to me who maybe get offended because they think I speak directly about them. But when I say church, in my head, I have nothing general and say I speak about that one thing and speaking about. Very often I speak about the Lutheran church, or very often I speak about church as a general. And there what I'm speaking, I would say is correctly.
Yeah.
And again, when that is said, the last years I have got more and more positive experience with pastor and with church and see God is really doing something also inside that church system and the way of doing church. And for some, I was just in Brazil, it was a big movement of a lot of churches. It was the first time I really met a whole network. Often I met priests like you and many priests, one priest there, and two priests there, five priests there in this country and there, who are on the same page and understanding. But in Brazil, I met a whole church network of hundreds of churches who actually was on the same page. So it's difficult to actually explain because I don't know who's sitting. I don't know who you are who's listening. There is people where I say, hey, there is a problem. And that is the problem, this is the problem, this is the problem, this is the problem. And some people can get offended.
Mm-hmm.
And they need to get offended.
Mm-hmm.
Because they are part of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
And you, by what you are doing in that church thing, is not the proof. Yeah. It's leading people astray because you do not preach the full gospel. You are led by people's money and fear by losing members more than the truth. And you should be offended by what I'm saying. And then there's other people who listen Well, relax, come on, I'm not talking about you.
Yeah.
I'm talking about that system, I'm talking about there where they are controlling people, where they are manipulating people, where they don't allow people to bear fruit, and so on and so on and so on.
Yeah.
And it is difficult in that way to do teaching, because we don't know who's behind.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you follow me?
Yes, I can follow you, yes. But what you say to the people who are perhaps sitting in the church is what they have to do.
Mm. When we do the PTS school here, we just today ended up with a new team. And I would say that we talk about, we don't spend a lot of time talking about what people do wrong. This is not our focus. We don't, people don't come here and then we talk about everything that's wrong, because then we can never stop, because there's so many things all over the world we could focus on. We talk about what is right and what we believe and what we want to gain and show the life. And out of that, we then tell, when people ask questions, we can tell stories. That's different. We can tell stories of people who came to the PTS school, went home to the church, and it started to grow.
Yeah.
And they started to do it in the church, and it became good, and they did not experience a problem.
Yeah.
We felt we can tell other stories of people who came to the PTS school, and they came home, and they couldn't handle it anymore, and they actually needed to leave the church.
Yeah.
We did not preach that they should leave the church. We just showed them the life, and they came from one of those churches where that life was not there. And now they got the life, and therefore they could not go back to the old thing. So it's so different from place to place, from people to people. I have been in Holland. There is one big church in Holland. I have been there 2 times during a big Kickstarter. There is a church in America. I'm going back there again. It's the second time in the same church. Big church building, pastor, they have everything. But he's not limiting that. He's free. So if I was there and I speak and I do it, those people who's in his church, they listen to the same sermon I do all over the place. They don't hear me say, leave the church.
Yeah.
But other places, people hear maybe the same sermon, exactly the same sermon, and in their words, they hear the Holy Spirit say, leave the church. Why?
Yeah.
Because they're in one of those places where there is no life.
Yeah.
So I'm not generally against the church. I just see our challenge with status quo, and we do what we already done.
Yeah.
And I'm provoking that system, and I'm saying, but this is not what God called us to. This is what God called us to. Some people inside church try to reform to come there. Some people go out because they cannot do it inside, and they go out and live it there. So I would say, this is the focus, this is what we want to do. And then what is happening is different from place to place. When that is said, what about unity? Because I know the question is, do I believe in unity?
Yeah,
no,
that's it.
I don't believe in unity. And yes, I believe in unity. No, I don't believe in unity in that place that I think that every big church system organization has to unite and come together. Because if we come to need to do that, then we will compromise. And we will end up under the biggest of them, and that is the Catholic Church. And there is a false movement going on right now, a unity movement, where they believe, oh, when we all come together and become one, then we will see a revival. There was only the Catholic Church, and they did not see revival at that time. So we had a guy, called Martin Luther, who did not believe in unity the way we preach it today, who said, no, that doctrine is wrong. So he needed to draw away from that. And we are happy for that today, because even so, the Lutheran Church is not the best thing, is better than that. And out of that, then there came the Baptist movement. And out of that, there was people saying, no, but we also need the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit came. And today, where we are only here where we are today, because there was people who said, I believe in something more important than we all come together, and that is the truth.
Yeah.
And that is the gospel, and I would not compromise in the truth. And because of that, we are now Protestant. Because of that, we are now Baptist, or we are now in a Pentecostal church. So people who talk about, oh, unity, 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 they forget where they come from.
Yeah.
This is one thing. When that is said, do I believe in unity? Yeah, I believe in unity, that when we are one in Christ, of course we'll be one with each other. And I love people who love Jesus. When God put us together, and I see really God is drawing people out from all over the place and putting us together as one body. And I filmed the PTS students today, and what most of them say, like, this is family, it's for summer experience, a unity like this. In John 17, when Jesus is talking about being one, I think we have misunderstood that scripture, in we think that being one is like this, we all come and become one. But when Jesus was walking on earth and talking about being one, he was here and the Father was here. He said, as I am in the Father, you are in me. He was there, the Father was in heaven. So when we are one with him, as he's one with the Father, and now he's there. So he's talking about a unity upward and not a unity that word. Because I can be a place where there is total split, and there is no unity amongst the churches, but if I'm one with him, the world will see and the world will believe because they see Christ in me. And in church history, there have always been split and conflicts, but when people start to live with God, it don't make it seem that everything become good and perfect, because there'll be more split, there'll be more conflict. Jesus said, don't believe I came with peace, but strife, there'll be division in families. Why? Because when the light is coming in, the darkness cannot be with the light, and there will be split. And Jesus experienced a split with the religious system at that time. So I believe in a unity where the focus, what Jesus is talking about, is unity between us and him in heaven. But when we are one with him in heaven, of course we are one with other people who is also one with him in heaven. So I believe in a kind of unity, but I do not believe in a unity on the sake of compromise.
Yeah.
And I believe that that we need to stand up and say, this is the truth, this is the truth, this is the truth. And then God will bring us together on that foundation, on that rock, on that truth. Who do I work with then? I can work with people who have that heart God put us together with. Do I work a lot with people from many other church denominations and Lutheran Catholic people and so on? No. Why not? Because I'm busy with doing what I'm doing, and I believe in preaching the gospel, I believe in doing that. But there is then people from Lutheran Church, Baptist Church, who receive that, and then I work with them, of course. But my focus is not, okay, now I need to sit down with everyone and spend all my time with that, because then I will not have time to do what God has called us to do, to preach the gospel.
Yeah.
But we're not fighting against. It's not like people come here, hey, we don't like you. What church are you from? Hey, you're from there, you're from there. We don't talk about that.
What's in your mindset? When